It's breaking news tonight, a new explanation and apology from an accused felon on the Russia probe of how a photo of the judge in his case turned up on his Instagram feed with a set of crosshairs over her shoulder. Just a short time ago, Roger Stone formally apologized for his post about Judge Amy Berman Jackson. We blurred her face out for a concern over her safety. Stone writes, please inform the court that the photograph and comment today was improper and should not have been posted. I had no intention of disrespecting the court and humbly apologize to the court for the transgression. Stone had earlier said the photo was misinterpreted and that any inference it was meant to somehow threaten the judge or disrespect the court is categorically false. He blamed the posting on one of his assistants. Joining us now is USA Today columnist and CNN political analyst Kirsten Powers, former Trump campaign aide Michael Caputo, and former Obama acting Solicitor General Neil Katyal. Neil, is what Stone posted on Instagram legal? Is it a, isn't it a crime to threaten a judge? Does that post meet the standard?
Yes, there are two issues. One is about Stone, the other is about Trump. With respect to Stone, it's undoubtedly a crime. 18 USC 115 says that it is a crime to threaten a federal judge. Now, he's tried to walk it back, saying, oh, I didn't mean it, and so on. The crosshairs were some logo or something like that. But let's be honest here. I mean, you know, this is a photo that he tweets attacking a federal judge with a big photo of her and a crosshairs on top of it. You know, that, you know, for the federal judiciary, which works so hard to try and safeguard all of us, this is a real problem. And then the other problem is Trump. You haven't heard a word from him about this. I mean, he talks all about the NFL protests and this and that whenever that happens. And here you've got one of his own closest confidants doing this, and you hear deafening silence. And, you know, we've put up with a lot in the past, Anderson, but the idea that, you know, that the president has silence when it comes to something like this and something that is such a core democratic value, protection of our federal judges, particularly at a time when some have been assassinated, is, I think, just an unforgivable thing.
Neil, could that apology spare Stone from having his bail revoked?
He can try. I think, you know, Judge Jackson is a phenomenal judge, respected by conservatives and liberals alike. I think she's not going to view this personally. I think she'll view it by the law. But I think by the law, this kind of stuff does constitute a threat. So there's potentially new criminal activity and criminal charges that could be brought. But at a minimum, I think it really does suggest this guy shouldn't be anywhere near bail or having the ability to communicate like this again.
Michael, potential legal fallout aside, is what Stone posted in any way defensible?
It's hard to defend something that's stupid, really. I mean, I've known Roger for 35 years. I haven't spoken to him since he was arrested out of an abundance of caution and on advice of our attorneys. But I understand his frustration with the way that things have gone down for him since his arrest. You know, there is some kind of an explanation that it's a neo-pagan symbol of some sort, not a crosshairs, but this kind of thing can be misinterpreted pretty quickly. And I want to, for a moment, step back and say that, you know, and commend Kirsten for what she posted today on her Twitter. She was talking about how she's been reflecting on the way things have gone down for all of us in recent months and talked about, you know, showing more grace in this mess of life. And life has gotten so really messy. Roger Stone's life has gotten really messy recently. This affidavit of apology to the court, I think, is a step in the right direction. He shouldn't have done this. He knows this now. I think it's he thinks it would be remarkable if Judge Jackson were able to give him a fair trial. I think it would be remarkable.
Do you think
if the judge were able to forgive him for this? I'm sorry?
Do you think the president should condemn what Stone did?
I don't think that it really is in the president's, purview to do this. I mean, you could say that Roger made a mistake. You could say that this is somewhat indefensible. People call it crosshairs. People call it a neo-pagan symbol. The fact of the matter is, Roger shouldn't have done it. He regrets it. He pulled it down. And I'm hoping that the judge sees this as another, you know, happenstance in the mess of life.
Yeah. But what about?
I'm sorry. How do you think that it couldn't be part of the president's obligation to do something? I mean, this is a president who tweets about SNL and NFL and everything else. This is the core thing a president does: stand up for the rule of law. He takes an oath that the law shall be faithfully executed. How could you say that isn't something the president should be condemning?
Well, Neil, I know you don't like the president's tweets. I've heard you complain about it for a while. Maybe the president will tweet about this. I'm not sure.
I'm asking for one.
Maybe he will, Neil. Maybe he will.
Kirsten, where do you stand on this?
Yeah, well, I mean, I think in a normal world, the president probably would condemn something like this. You would think that the president would want to be standing up for the judiciary. But I think we all know we don't really live in a normal world. And I think even if you were to give Michael Cohen the benefit of the doubt on the crosshairs, he wrote a bunch of crazy stuff about the judge. I'm sorry, what did I say?
Michael Cohen.
Oh, okay. Even if we were to give him the benefit of the doubt, then you have to look at everything he was saying. It's a show trial. It's the deep state. It's like this judge is part of some sort of cabal and out to get him. I mean, I don't understand in what scenario this is normal behavior or acceptable behavior or why it would even be a good idea.
Neil, I want to ask you about...
I think Roger Stone's attorneys agree with you.
Yeah. Neil, I want to ask you about the ongoing questions around President Trump's relationship with Vladimir Putin, particularly something that former FBI acting director Andrew McCabe said on 60 Minutes. I just want to play it for our viewers.
The president launched into several unrelated diatribes. One of those was commenting on the recent missile launches by the government of North Korea. And essentially, the president said he did not believe that the North Koreans had the capability to hit us here with ballistic missiles in the United States. And he did not believe that because President Putin had told him they did not. President Putin had told him that the North Koreans don't actually have those missiles.
And U.S. intelligence was telling the president what?
Intelligence officials in the briefing responded that that was not consistent with any of the intelligence our government possesses. To which the president replied, "I don't care. I believe Putin."
Now, if you're Robert Mueller, are you hearing this on 60 Minutes for the first time, or is this already part and parcel of your investigation?
I suspect he probably knows some of this because, I think there have been a number of interviews. But, I mean, to hear it in that way, "I don't care," the president said about the intelligence community assessments, "I believe Putin." That is an amazing thing. I mean, our intelligence community works so hard day in and out to try and get it right. And, I understand that there's a lot of people who have suspicion about the intelligence community. When I was 27 and my first tour at the Justice Department, I was a lefty and thought, oh, these people are nightmares and so on. Within a week, you learn the truth about the intelligence community. I mean, these people work incredibly hard on a non-political basis. If anything, they might skew a little conservative, but they just work hard to get it right. And here you've got the president saying, "I don't believe them. I believe our mortal enemy, Putin." I think Mueller and the Congress are going to look into that.
Kirsten, it shouldn't be surprising, though. I mean, the president said essentially the same thing in front of the entire world in Helsinki when he said that, Dan Coats had said one thing, but that Putin had given a very strong, manly, powerful response that he believed.
Yeah, right. So I think had that not happened, maybe you could say, well, possibly, this doesn't ring true or it doesn't sound right. But of course, as you pointed out, we've seen this movie before. And so it's not, it's shocking still to think that the president would think this, the president of the United States would possibly believe somebody like Putin over his own intelligence community. But we have seen it before. And I think, there's been a lot of talk about how inappropriate all of this was about, alleged talk of 25th Amendment and so on, and these concerns about the president. But I think, if you have to kind of step back and ask, why would they be having these concerns and why would they be behaving in the way they were behaving if there wasn't something really unusual going on? And that's basically the story that's being told, which is that this was so alarming, what they were seeing, and so unusual. So it's not just a bunch of people sitting around like, hey, let's maybe do the 25th Amendment. There was something really behind it. I don't think they ever really were going to invoke it, but they were seriously concerned.
Kirsten Paris, Michael Caputo, Neil Cadiel, thank you very much. A quick reminder.